Christmas one under in a Baba dance room. Keep watching Sekondi Catholic now.
Hello, welcome to Sekondi Catholic TV on YouTube and the Kala Sekondi Catholic page on Facebook. Exactly on this day, 20th November, 50 years ago, the Kadas of Sekondi Takoradi was created. And this evening, I am privileged to be hosting Monsignor Francis Aboa Kwansa, the Apostolic Administrator's Delegate and the Chairman of the Golden Jubilee Planning Committee of the Diocese. Monsignor, you are welcome.
Thank you.
Monsignor, how significant is 20th November to the Diocese of Sekondi Takoradi?
Well, you just said it. 20th November is a year of great significance to the diocese because it is not too far from saying that this is our birthday as a diocese. It's the day also in the legal understanding of who we are. An entity which has a legal life of its own, and by which I mean it becomes an entity with a kind of duties, obligations. It becomes an entity which has the right to own, to sue, and to be sued.
Okay.
I mean, all that goes to describe a juridical person.
Okay.
This is the day that we as a church, you know, assume that status.
Okay.
So, yes, a day of great significance to the diocese as an individual, you know, entity, you know, which has a life of its own.
Okay. Monsignor, walk us through how the creation of the diocese came about.
The creation of the diocese, well, you know, for us in the Catholic Church, we take as our prime concern, our primary concern, the fact that the Lord Jesus did not just walk the face of the earth and leave us, but the Lord Jesus left us and left his church as an institution, as an organizational structure, a structure with a life of its own. And for us in the Catholic Church, the mandate to go out into the whole world to proclaim the gospel is addressed to us not just as individuals, but also as a collective, and more than a collective, also as an organic institution. And by this I mean that that organic institution has a life of its own.
Okay.
Even though in the very beginning we do not have it as structured as we have today, we have the seeds of it already shown in the organization of the church from the time of the Lord Jesus Christ. We have the apostles, yeah, and the apostles together with the Holy Father, the Pope, who occupies the see of Peter. Peter is the one who summons the apostles in a communion of charity. You know, he heads that system. And even though we know that from Scripture the apostles didn't have a really coherent form of organization, but it was always there clear from the early councils and all that that Peter is the one who moves this institution forward. Whenever they met, he was very primary in the consideration of whatever decisions that we would arrive at. And more to it, we also see that over the years, the Catholic Church, as it organized itself, you know, did not leave itself as a splinter group. There has been always this kind of organic structure moving in there.
Okay.
So to come down to addressing your question, what happens is that the organizational structure of the church in the very beginning took its pattern from the organization of the Roman Empire.
Okay.
In fact, all the terminologies like dioceses and parishes and all the different entities and all that.
Yeah.
If you go closely into Roman law, into the Justinian law and all that, these are the kind of structures that you find.
Okay.
It's as if you are describing the local government system and
okay.
all these what we are struggling with now, with all the districts
and all that.
But then you have the parishes, you have the dioceses, you have the provinces and all
okay.
that. And it was just taken over as a church.
Okay.
And that's the way we organized ourselves.
Okay.
You know, with the church being established in Rome, the Peter also assumed the leadership of the church.
Okay.
You know, until much later, when the Roman Empire divided the East and Western,
yeah.
we know what happens and how in the East, the Eastern Rite Church, you know, deepens itself and forms an organizational structure of its own, while the West and the Rome also develops along its own models and structures. So, for the most part, the church was alive in Europe, in the Middle East and all that. And for us in Africa, the church came along with the age of exploration.
Okay.
You know, beginning with the Portuguese adventures
yeah.
and all that. And you all know, before that, anyway, we used to be told that the story of the church in Africa
yeah.
went way back, even in the Roman times, you know, when North Africa was basically. Very Christian and Catholic for that matter. We have St. Augustine, we have St. Cyprian, we have all those things you know, to show for it.
Yeah.
You know. But picking, looking forward to what was accomplished, we see that the age of exploration actually started the real beginnings of the founding of the faith in Africa, south of the Sahara.
Mm-hmm.
And we are privy to the fact that already in 1482, the Portuguese came down and started their trading.
Yeah.
And along with the traders came also chaplains who took care of the spiritual needs of the early colonizers,
mm-hmm.
you know, for good or for bad.
Okay.
But that was how things began.
Okay.
You know. Back here in our own diocese, we historians tell us that, in fact, the first touch of the church was when some of these explorers visited Shama,
yeah.
you know, and in Shama, even though the mass was not formally celebrated, they planted a cross.
The wooden cross,
yeah. the famous wooden cross
yeah.
of Shama. And so it makes Shama very much a very important part of the history of evangelization in the western part of Ghana.
Okay.
And for that matter, the church in Ghana as a whole.
Okay.
So it's from this perspective that we can say, especially after the first days of exploration, when the history began to the tide of history change and all that.
Mm.
There was a discontinuation, and then the years of the Protestant movement with its attendant different strifes and wars in Europe and all that, the Hundred Days Wars and all that, you know, they all affected the way evangelization went until finally evangelization started in earnest in our part of the world in the 19th century.
Yeah.
And we have made great strides. And the more the church makes strides, the more the church, like a living organism, also divides itself.
Okay.
You know, kind of to replicate itself, grow and all that. And it's from that, you know, biological description that we can see the church finally also was grown from the church in the Archdiocese of Cape Coast, who served as our province leader. Yeah. And then from that, the Sekondi Takoradi Diocese was born, when the Holy Father judged that we have arrived at a stage in our history whereby we could also exist as a real entity, as a church.
Viewers, if you just join us, you are live on Sektari Kali TV on YouTube and the Kala Sosengagari page on Facebook. Today, the Diocese of Sekondi Takoradi is 50 years, and we are talking about the diocese as it celebrated 50th anniversary. And doing this discussion with Monsignor Francis Abuapansa, who is the Apostolic Administrator's Delegate and the Chairman of the Golden Jubilee Planning Committee. Monsignor, we continue our conversation. You mentioned this organic relationship. How would you describe the relationship between the Diocese of Cape Coast, Sekondi Takoradi, and then the Diocese of Eosu?
One word, basically. Okay. It's a province.
Okay.
In juridical terms, you know, we call it a province.
Okay.
And a province is a, what do you call it, a circumscription of a of an area of the church.
Okay.
Where there are different dioceses. You know, when we say a diocese, we just simply mean that an area where it's a circumscription of the, that portion of the people of God with their own bishopship. You know, who is head and all that, who is independent. But at the same time, his authority, you know, subsists under the authority of the Holy Father. But as a province, any number of people may be put into that circumscription to constitute a province. And that means that they try to harmonize, let's say, discipline, liturgical discipline for that matter. They try to draw on each other's pastoral programs so that there's some kind of uniformity
common
ground or something. And even though each bishop is authority on his own in area of governance of his own diocese, there is still the need, you know, for each bishop to join hands with other bishops in the province. You know, and the province is always headed by the archbishop. And of course, nobody tells you, especially when we meet as a province and you see the archbishop wearing what they call the pallium.
Yeah.
That is a symbol of his authority. Otherwise, you wouldn't even know who is the archbishop and who is the ordinary bishop.
Ojo, going further, what are some of the landmarks during this 50th anniversary of the Diocese of Sekondi Takoradi?
Landmarks is been a continuum of what we've been doing way back when we were in the archdiocese. We're part and parcel of the archdiocese of Cape Coast. In terms of style of organization, we always had our schools, you know, especially the basic schools.
Okay.
And at that time, you know, we had the second cycle institutions too, like St. John's, Archbishop Porter Girls, St. Mary's. Though St. Mary's has warped and has transformed itself from college to secondary school. You know, we had Bogoso, you know. And then, apart from the education thing, we had hospitals.
Yeah.
To the best of my recollection, we've added up to the hospital because the main hospitals that we had at the time, before we became a diocese, was the St. Kigwa Diocese, but I was thinking more to it about the Western North area in the sense of
Asafo,
St. John of God.
Okay.
That was the very big part of the institution was there in our in this province.
Okay.
But I think Igwa and then Ikwe, which just recently celebrated its 60th anniversary of our institution. I think it will be 65 next year.
Oh, okay.
But lately too, we have also had added Fijai Holy Child Hospital.
Yeah.
You know, and then we've added we just built the latest pediatric hospital in Apoa, under the leadership of Most Reverend John Bonaventure Kofi.
Yeah.
And we've also had some clinics added on to what we have. The one in Emuni and the pop of you know. So we don't seem to be doing badly at all. We have about 9 or so health facilities, all dotted in areas very strategic in the whole of the Western region.
Okay.
And I dare say that without these health institutions, our people will be very much languishing with a lot of all these diseases struggling. So I think the diocese can pat itself on the back that we're not doing badly from that point of view. And added to that, our other area of responsibility, the schooling and all that, has been doing well. We've had school for the, what do you call it, other
the special school.
The special school.
Okay. You know, At Fijai.
You know, and that seems to be doing quite well. We also had the same group.
Inclusive.
Unfortunately, that institution is not doing too well.
Okay.
I don't know whether it's because of the prejudices that culture we have against those with other kind of disabilities and all that. And so it doesn't seem to have too much sponsorship.
Okay.
And we pray that as we go on, many more people will subscribe to that school. And also beyond that, we have some benefactors to help establish it for families.
Okay.
But so, yes. Even our brothers with other abilities and all that, issues of that nature is also being addressed in our diocese.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, Mazion, as part of this Golden Jubilee celebration of the diocese, who are some of the pioneer priests of this diocese? And do you have some of them still alive?
I don't have good news for you in that stance. It's 50 years.
Okay.
And it's amazing what happens in 50 years. We talk about 50 years.
Yeah.
But like I noted when we were celebrating the Jubilee for our deceased clergy and religious, you know, sadly, we don't have a single soul surviving from the 50 years since the diocese was created.
Wow.
You know, we've had very excellent priests too, for that matter. It needs to be mentioned. We had Monsignor Pustin, you know,
Sacramentebra.
Yes, the Sacramentebra. You have like Takoradi people and priests, where he worked, you know, where he's almost left that as his, you know, landmark.
Mm-hmm.
You know. And he speaks to deep theology about the Catholic, the Catholic way of life by that simple.
Mm-hmm.
But it was great. You know, we've had Father Monsieur Enu, you know, who nearly became he was the Vicar Capitular when our revered first bishop, Most Reverend Joseph Amnesia, died. And I think it must be said that Bishop Amnesia was a very, very assertive and a very organized and a very dedicated, bishop and priest. And I think he set the train. He paved the trail for and the tone for all of us to study and to follow. It said of him that, you know, he was such so organized that whenever he left the place, you just went and then you just sat in the chair. Everything was so orderly. Methodically arranged, orderly, you know. And he was quite a fantastic, very principled, you know, bishop. I don't say that others have not been, but if you knew Bishop Bishop, even my description of him would fall far short, you know. And sometimes perhaps because of his strictness and ascetic character and all that, people didn't understand him very much. But there again, God has a way of making his calls on who believe what and that. So these are some of the.
Also, before you go on, you just mentioned Bishop Isuya by describing him.
Yeah.
For the other bishop, in one sentence, how would you describe them to us? Bishop Sam, Bishop Dakun. What memories do you have of
Bishop Sam was a very affable character. Very affable. And very very compassionate. You know, and he wasn't, of course, as strict as Bishop Isuya. You know, but you can't deny his generosity of spirit and character. I think that is, you can't beat Bishop Sam.
Okay,
that way. Yeah. Everybody, and those who came, whoever came his way, knew that they were approaching somebody with a heart, ready to listen. Bishop Taku,
your old classmate.
My old classmate. He was a little bit older than me. Bishop Taku equally, you know, was quite generous. He was detailed, and then in his own way, he always ensured that the writing would be done. Unfortunately, he was not always well understood, and that is clear from whatever difficulties that he had with the situation at Ijam Goto and all that. But yes, Bishop Dapu, in his own way, was a very generous person, bishop, and priest, and then he was also full of concern and he had a love for the diocese. Mm-hmm. I think all bishops that we've had, the three who are deceased, you know, and the last one who is now our administrator, the Archbishop of Accra, we've been lucky to have leaders, shepherds who have a passion, you know, for the leading the flock, and who are quite empathetic and generous in their own way, shepherding the flock.
Monsieur, how has the diocese celebrated this golden jubilee?
Oh, it's been a long haul, you know. You are the secretary of the jubilee committee. When we started, we didn't know that we would meet all these surprising, turbulence.
Yeah.
I should put it that way, turbulence, in a sense that we planned it all with Archbishop Kofi, and we set our own pace. And then after the inauguration, at Sekondi, Pro Cathedral, we thought that the year-long celebration would go on, as planned. But then, barely after that, just as we entered into the new year, news broke that our bishop, had been transferred to Accra.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, we thought that was going to be a setback for the whole thing. And I would even in that reason revise the whole program. But Bishop, you know, our Bishop is also a man of his word. Mm-hmm. He said, no, we'll go on, you know. And so we have. We've had, and he's been also generous with time. Mm-hmm. When he could, you know, he would always be present. When he couldn't, he would ask me to, you know, to fill in and to his big shoes, mm-hmm. Which I've proudly done, mm-hmm. but could have walked into big shoes. Anyway, so we've done that, and we visited all sectors of the diocese, as you know. We've had the Jubilee for Catechese,
yeah.
which we celebrated at Takwa. We had a Jubilee for the youth,
yeah,
we celebrated at the Jam. Also, we had Jubilee for the sick,
yeah.
we celebrated in individual parishes,
yeah.
and all that. We had Jubilee for the disabled. We went to Jai and all that. We have Jubilee for the women and men and all that.
Mm-hmm.
We celebrate the cathedral. We encourage people to celebrate in the parishes and deaneries. We have Jubilee for
the priest.
For the priest, yeah. For the Jubilee for the priest.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we celebrate at during Takoradi. You know, the clergy and religious,
yeah,
just
yeah. Mm-hmm.
not forget our
brothers
and sisters, religious, you know,
okay.
and so on and so forth. So it's like almost every month there has been something to celebrate,
okay.
on a grand scale,
mm-hmm.
you know, and in that way, I think by and large, every part and every life, society group, in the diocese has had an opportunity to celebrate this jubilee. And lately, of course, earlier this month, we celebrated the jubilee for our deceased
clergy
and religious. Not to mention the fact that we also encourage our lay faithful to celebrate the jubilee of all our deceased, you know, lay faithful
yeah.
in the past, you know, recalling them in their parishes
mm-hmm.
where they've gone and all that, and paying tribute to whatever contributions that we have made in growing the life of the church. You know.
Well, now that I have you here, as part of the Jubilee celebration, come the 30th of November, the diocese, with the help of the Holy Father, will be conferring on 21 individuals some papal awards. Are you able to explain to us what these awards mean to the diocese and to the church in Sekondi, Takoradi?
Well, as part of the Jubilee celebration, the Most Reverend John Bonaventure Kofi thought it very proper and expedient to have at least some of the lay people, you know, recognized. For their roles that they have played, and the roles that they have played in the sense that they are symbolic, you know, for themselves and also for us as a diocese, you know, and not only the lay faithful but also the clergy. So both clergy and religious members have been considered for these papal awards. The clergy, we've had two consigliere in the persons of Father
Austin,
Father Margaret Nisu,
okay.
you know, and Father Joseph Jim Austin, you know, and for the lay people, I've had awards coming in, like from the order of Gregory the Great, you know, Gregory the Great himself, Gregory being one of the forefathers of the church,
yeah.
along with St. Augustine.
Because we are running out of time,
mm-hmm.
will there be other recognitions also as part of the celebration? apart from these?
Well, we have got Gregory and Sylvester, the Order of Sylvester, and the, what do you call it? The Cross Pro Ecclesia at Pontificia for the Church and the Holy Father.
Okay.
For the distinct services that they have rendered in the name of the Church and the Holy Father.
Okay.
And we have had also people who are rewarded for meritorious service.
Services.
Bene Merente.
Okay.
Yep. And people who have done themselves good.
Okay.
And then finally there will be a host of papal awards, you know, by way of certificates for a host of people in the cut across parishes from the diocese in the length and breadth of our diocese.
Okay.
Yeah. They will get some of these certificates and blessings.
Okay.
And of course, some of our own clergy too.
Okay.
Who have braced the toil, the hard heat of the day.
Yeah.
I think it's good to recognize them. The wish is that perhaps we could recognize everybody. By recognizing everybody also means that you are recognizing nobody.
Yeah.
So some of the clergy, especially who have served long years in the diocese, will also naturally be recognized.
Okay.
So that in some, the awards must not be seen as maybe because X got it and Y didn't get it, it means X is better than Y.
Okay.
It totally shows that their their merits, their qualities, their graces and all that is so overwhelming that it covers all of us.
Okay.
And in covering all of us, it also brings out the good in all of us as a people, as a diocese, as a people of God.
Well, when is the climax of the Golden Jubilee?
The climax is Golden Jubilee. That's week that you're talking about, from 30th when we do the
awards. Yeah.
No, through that week to the 8th, the Sunday, which is the
Thanksgiving.
The celebration of Mass of Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that whole week will be the high point for the all that we do throughout the year. And hopefully for the high point, when we meet to give thanks to God, we'll have not only our Archbishop presiding, but the head of state himself who brings the occasion.
Okay.
You know, and join us all into the hands of God, thanking him for what he's done for our diocese.
Viewers, it has been wonderful coming your way this afternoon. We had a discussion with Monsieur Francis Abuakansa, who is the Apostolic Administrator's Delegate and the Chairman for the Golden Jubilee Planning Committee. Today, the Diocese of Sekondi Takoradi celebrates her 50th anniversary. Remember to say a prayer for the diocese. And remember, from the 30th to the 8th of December is the highest point of this climax of the anniversary celebration. So I come here again. Keep watching Sekondi TV and God bless you. Bye-bye.
Oh, my, I'm for stable, oh, still. rejoice and sing. Rise up, Cali, faithful, rejoice and sing. Let us come together with one accord. Rise up, Cali, faithful, come and praise the Lord. Let us come together, build our church together. As we pray together, arise, arise, arise. Hallow, praise and glory give unto the Lord, your God. Rise up, Cali, faithful, come and praise the Lord. Let us come together, build our church together. As we pray together, arise, arise, arise. Hallow, praise and glory give unto the Lord.